Welcome to the bookshelf brought to you by the Institute of South Asian Studies at the National University of Singapore. I'm your host, Chulani Athanayaka, a research fellow at ISAS. I have with me Professor Asoka Bandarage to discuss her latest publication, Colonialism in Sri Lanka, the Political Economy of Candian Highland, 1833 to 1886. Professor Bandarage was educated at the University of Sri Lanka, Bryn Mawr College, and at Yale University, where she received a PhD in sociology. She has served on the faculties of Brandeis University, Georgetown University, and Mount Holyoke College. She is currently Distinguished Adjunct Professor at the California Institute of Integral Studies, where she teaches ecological consciousness and climate justice. Her interdisciplinary teaching and writing span across many fields, including political economy, conflict analysis, women's studies, population, ecology, philosophy, and public policy. The book on discussion today, Colonialism in Sri Lanka, was first published in 1983. It is a classic work on the history of British colonialism and the impact of British plantation economy and political authority in the 19th century. So the question is why we are discussing this in 2021. This book published its second edition in 2020 with an extensive chapter on neocolonialism in Sri Lanka. And it puts the current great power struggle in Sri Lanka into comparative perspective. It also shows interesting parallels to the British colonialism in the island nation. So without further ado, let's hear from Professor Bandarage. Welcome, Professor Bandarage. Thank you for joining with us in this discussion.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much for this opportunity to discuss the book with you.
So, Professor Bandarage, the book was first published in 1983. Can you tell the viewers what this book is about?
Right. The book is about the introduction of the plantation economy in Sri Lanka under British colonial rule. It covers the first 50 years or so of the origin and the establishment of the plantation economy. So it's a very critical period in the history of the island. It's the period where the transformation as a dependent capitalist economy began, and it led to massive social transformations as well. So I did this book because at the beginning of my own scholarly career and focusing on Sri Lanka, I realized that I didn't really know the history of the country myself, because history had been written mostly from the modernization perspective, upholding the values and the trajectory of economic development that was set in place by the British. But I wanted to have a more in-depth understanding of the nature of this process and also its impact on local populations and the land and the country in general. So that's what led me to this research, which is based on the use of primary documents, especially colonial documents. So it's a very incisive analysis of how the plantations were established and how they impacted, particularly on the Candian peasantry.
What led you to do a revised edition?
Yeah, as you mentioned, the first edition was published in 1983. There was a Sri Lankan edition published in 1985 by Lake House Publishers. Then there was a Stamford Lake Publishers issued both an English and a Sinhala translation in 2005, I believe. But all those editions are now out of print. So the book is really not available to either the Sri Lankan audience or the global readership. And given its value in understanding current developments, colleagues encouraged me to help bring out this second edition. Okay. At which, as you say, mentioned has a whole new chapter at the end on neocolonialism in Sri Lanka, looking at the current developments.
So Professor Bandarage, one of the main aspects you discuss in this book is about administrative and institutional changes during the British rule. How this changed the pre-colonial economic and social order in Sri Lanka, and what are the significant impacts of this transformation on Sri Lanka's economy, politics, and society?
Yeah, so I hope that the listeners would go and read the book, because it is extremely detailed, and I will just give a brief summary. It has chapters on land, labor, colonial state, after discussing the pre-colonial social formation. I spent a lot of time looking at how land was obtained, how private property rights were introduced, particularly vis-a-vis the highlands, which peasantry used for their highland, what was called Swidden or Chena cultivation. And they had customary rights to these lands, but they could not really prove ownership. So when the British came and they needed vast tracts of land for plantation development, they were eyeing this land, which they claimed was crown land, crown meaning belonging to the royalty of England, who had never set foot on the land. So they required the peasants to prove ownership and titles to this land, for which they couldn't provide that in the vast majority of cases. So there was a ordinance called the Crown Lands Encroachment Ordinance of 1840, which I discuss in great detail, and how that was used to expropriate land from the peasantry and then also sell it at very minimal, really for a pittance, to mostly British planters for the development of the plantation economy. And then over time, how the peasantry became a landless peasantry, particularly with the introduction of private property rights, as well as the commoditization of land. The peasants themselves started to sell whatever land they had because they could not keep up with the monetary demands of a changing economy, like, for example, the taxes. There were a whole series of taxes that were imposed on the peasantry by the colonial state. And also rice cultivation, the staple production of staple goods, was neglected, and rice came to be imported and people had to start buying the rice. So they needed more cash. And oftentimes the peasantry would sell their land in order to get cash. And sometimes they would end as tenant laborers on their own ancestral properties. So it's much more complicated than how I'm presenting here, because I look at, the different types of lands and the different types of legislation and institutional structures that were employed.
Very interesting, Professor Bandarage. So you emphasize in the book on how Sri Lanka's economy, politics, and culture were often influenced by external intervention, and how such interventions faced local resistance. What are the parallels you see between the British colonial period and today's context in this regard?
Yeah, there are a lot of parallels, because what we have going on today is a continuation of that same process of global capitalist development, the introduction of transnational corporations into the local context, because these plantations were mostly British plantations and they were transnational. I think that from the beginning, there was also resistance. There was resistance to the imposition of British rule. There was resistance to imposition of plantations, particularly by the Kandyan peasantry, that did not want to become a permanent labor force on the plantations. They wanted to carry on in their customary fashion, having access to land and engaged in their own cultivation rather than producing cash crops for export. So there was, for example, in 1848, there was a rebellion against British rule, which was also was caused because of very severe taxation on the peasantry, to the extent that, the peasantry couldn't bear the burden of the taxes. And that also led to, certain sort of nationalist feelings of, certain leadership emerged to mobilize peasants. But these rebellions, not only the 1848 rebellion, but the 1818 rebellion at the very beginning of the British rule in the Candian Kingdom, was put down very harshly. I mean, the 1818 rebellion was put down through a scorched earth policy. Like in certain areas in the Uver Vellasa region, entire villages were burned and large numbers of people, including certain local aristocracy who supported the national rebellion, were killed. So there was a heavy cost paid, which is oftentimes neglected in mainstream discussions of British colonial rule. So, as I said, this is a continuation of a pattern, but we are entering a new historical juncture. We have entered a new historical juncture in this process of global capitalist development. What I study in the book, much of the book, is that original phase of the imposition. But now we are entering a new phase. So although Sri Lanka is nominally independent, we have what has been called flag independence, like many other ex-colonial countries. Increasingly, the natural resources, the ports, the mineral resources, etc., are being controlled by external forces, because there is intense global competition now between these emerging powers for the control of what is left of the global natural resources, especially minerals and land. So there is a kind of a land grab that is going on, which needs to be seen in the context of corporate development. So, for example, the World Economic Forum says we are now entering a new age of the post-pandemic global reset. And when they envisage this new world, they see a digitalized society. It is connected digitally. People don't possess anything. People don't own anything. So if people don't own anything, who owns the resources? It's these corporations and a handful of people who represent corporate interests. So there's incredible inequality now and dispossession of the vast majority of people. So what is happening in Sri Lanka is actually what is happening all over the world, but we are looking at the particular dimensions of the Sri Lankan experience, which is even more complex because of Sri Lanka's strategic location in the heart of the Indian Ocean, in perhaps the busiest maritime trade route, the east-west trade route. So that which should be a blessing for Sri Lanka in a way has become a curse, because all these external powers want to control this strategic place, or with these natural harbor like in Trincomalee, and also Hambantota, which is a very important harbor, and Colombo, which is one of the busiest harbors in the world. And also ilmenite, titanium, mineral sands of other kinds. So there are lots of natural resources. There's a strategic position. So China has incorporated Sri Lanka into the BRI, the Belt Road Initiative. As we know, they have a 99-year lease on the Hambantota port. They've built this port city in Colombo. And you know, various other projects like the hybrid energy projects in some islands of Jaffna. Then India has control over the oil tank farm in Trincomalee, also the western terminal of the Colombo port. They also have been trying to get this ECTA bilateral trade agreement with Sri Lanka, which would be very beneficial to India. And of course, the United States, which tried to introduce this MCC, Millennium Challenge Cooperation Pact, which was mostly to register land, because 80% of the land still belongs to the state, register in a digitalized registers, facilitating privatization and commoditization so that it would, they very clearly stated that the objective was of the MCC was to make the land available for commercial corporate development. But again, like in 1848, 1888, 1818, there were these rebellions. There was massive resistance against the MCC compact, as you know, and so the government did not sign it. But many fear that although it's not signed, that many aspects of it are still being moved forward, because there's enormous pressure on Sri Lanka, not only this administration, but previous administrations as well, to go along with these different agendas of these external powers. For example, there is a new energy company, an American company, that has signed an agreement to develop liquid naturalized gas and also to supply gas to power plants in Sri Lanka. So a lot of activists are very concerned about the energy sector and electricity to the power grid being controlled by an external corporation. What are its implications for the sovereignty and independence of the country? So there are just a whole host of issues regarding economic independence as well as political and also cultural independence, which is a whole other set of questions.
Professor Bandaragi, since you already touched upon the MCC, let me prod a little bit more into this. MCC was one of the most controversial agreements that was discussed in the public political discourse, and it became a hot topic during the past presidential election, where the candidates from both main political parties pledged to scrap the deal if they get elected. Now, in this book, you compare the MCC agreement to that of colonial land expropriation. Can you explain to our listeners and elaborate on this a little bit? And how similar or different is the MCC agreement to that of British colonial land policies?
For example, if you look at the 1840 Crown Lands Ordinance, and as I mentioned before, how it was used to expropriate land for plantation development. So it provided the juridical and administrative structure to do that. And similarly with the MCC, you know, there is the attempt to register land. A lot of land in Sri Lanka is still not registered. Register land, digitalize them, make it very quickly available for sale, and facilitate this commoditization. So agribusiness corporations and other corporations can come and make use of that land for their own development. So there is a close parallel, although the specifics are different, it is the same process of alienation of resources, not for necessarily for the benefit of the locals, but for external interests. And of course, you have to have a local collaborator class to do that. Colonialism relied upon that. I mean, colonialism involved a very small group of Europeans coming into other lands. So they needed to develop a local collaborator class to carry on the the administration and help move the colonial project forward. So oftentimes you find that local administrations, even today, although they are independent in name, have an enormous amount of pressure put on them to accept the agendas coming from the outside. And you know, there are various incentives and threats involved, that some of which we may even not know about.
Clearly, Sri Lanka has become a strategic space for all the competing great powers in today's international politics, and they are trying to woo and influence Sri Lanka to realize their interests. So I think sometimes successive governments attempt to nationalize policies as a way of mitigating this situation. But as we know, they have not been sustainable. Given current deepened economic issues, can Sri Lanka survive with nationalized policies?
Yeah, I mean, this is a kind of a universal global problem. You know, most countries are facing this. It's become almost impossible to move on an independent path of socioeconomic development, because all countries and all regions are integrated into this one world economy, which is about driven by profit, which is committed to sort of fast-paced growth, large-scale infrastructure, which oftentimes does not benefit the majority of the people. It disrupts local society, communities, cultures, and even most importantly, it disrupts ecology, the environment. Now, I've written elsewhere about the impact of monocultural plantation economy and development, and how it affected land erosion and a host of environmental problems, including displacement of animals, the whole animal, like the elephant-human, so-called human-elephant conflict. So I think that it's very difficult for a country like Sri Lanka to go on a path of its own without sort of partnership with other countries in similar situations. So it is unfortunate that the non-alignment movement of the early post-independence era is almost non-existent. Because that was not just a movement for neutrality from the Cold War, but it was also a movement for economic independence and for countries to go on their own economic models of economic development, like some in African socialism, and so many different terminologies were used. So I think it's really important to have a more collective approach to work with other countries and to strengthen sort of the southern partnerships. And even more importantly, I think it's essential to have greater unity within the country. Now, divide and conquer was a very common strategy of colonialism. The divisions along political party lines, the divisions along ethno-religious lines, you know, divide people against each other, communities against each other, so they are going at each other rather than focusing on national unity, protection of natural resources, protection of the environment, the health of the people, etc. So, and the external forces also use these and they manipulate them, and not just in the past. Under the British, it was very clear how they did that. But it is also happening in very sophisticated ways today. And for people to kind of wake up and have a consciousness about the country, its ecological unity, and the necessity to come together to face these issues, I think is important. Otherwise, what Sri Lanka would be and already is becoming is just a shell and only a free in name. But parts and parts, different parts of it is all owned and controlled by external forces. So I think, you know, it's we need rethinking and transformation of consciousness. So I'm glad. Thank you for the opportunity to even express these few thoughts, and you know, keep up your good work.
On that note, thank you, Dr. Bandarge, for joining us today, and it was a very interesting discussion. I learned a lot about Sri Lanka's colonial history from the book and this discussion, and I'm sure the our viewers also learned a lot from this. And the parallels we see today are very interesting. So, dear viewers, we hope you enjoyed this book discussion on Professor Bandarge's latest book, Colonialism in Sri Lanka, The Political Economy of the Candian Highlands, 1833 to 1886. And I hope this discussion have tempted you to read this book. And also, if you are interested to learn more about our analysis and our work at ISAS, please visit our website, isas.nus.edu.sg.